Hello everyone, welcome to the first video in my new genealogy tutorial series. In today's video, I will be going over the What Are the Odds tool on DNA Painter. The What Are the Odds tool is something that you use when you have a DNA tester who has multiple genetic matches that are descending from a specific family. By using this tool, you can find out the likely place that your DNA tester fits into this family. So to start, all you need to do is go to dnapainter.com/tools. There's no need to have an account with DNA Painter. You don't need to log in to use the What Are the Odds tool. Once you go to the link, you will find this page and just click this button and you will get this opening page. Now, starting your tree on What Are the Odds is pretty straightforward. I find it best to start with the ancestor couple that all of these descendants are descending from. So you're going to go over to this first node and you'll see when you hover over it that you have edit names, add child, and add parent. So the first thing I do is I'll just edit names and I'll put in the name of this couple. So in the case that we're going to use today, the couple we're going to call MM and ED. So we're just going to put it in like this. And we're going to hit save updated name. So now that we have the name in, we want to add the children. In the case that I'm going to show you, we have descendants who are descending from four different children. And so we're just going to go here and we're going to click on add child. Go hover over here and we're going to do edit name. So the first child we're going to put in is Jane. And so we're going to just do that. Then we're going to go back up and we're going to add another child. And this child is Abraham. I'm going to save that. Then the next child we're going to put in is Sadie. And the next child after that is Lewis. So we've got Sadie and Lewis. So now we have the four children. And from here, we're just going to keep adding the children until we get to the genetic matches. So with Jane, we actually have four children. And we can actually just click this four times. And then we can add the names from here. So she has four children who have descendants that are matches to our tester. So for this first one, we're going to put name is MNV. This next one, we're going to put the name is EC, then SS and RC. Okay, and so we're just going to keep going down and adding these. So MN had one child. We're going to call them MNV2. And then we're going to add a child for MNV2, and that is going to be SR. Now, SR is the first node on the tree that we've put in that is one of the genetic matches. So now that we're here, we are going to want to put in the amount of centimorgans that SR is matching our tester. In this case, SR is matching at 93 centimorgans. So we're going to go down to enter match centimorgans. We're going to enter 93 and we're going to save. And now you'll see that SR has the 93 centimorgans. So we're going to keep doing this. So with EC, they actually have two children that have descendants who are matches. So for this, we're going to put MC. And for this one, we're going to put JC. And for MC, they have a child who we're going to call MCP. And MCP is also a match. And she matches at 114 centimorgans. And then JC is also he's not a match. His son is a match. So we're going to add that JC. And the amount that JC matches is 112. And so we're going to go through the entire tree and we're going to add this. So I'm going to finish building this tree and I'm just going to fast forward through it. But you'll be able to see how I build it. And then we're going to start placing our hypotheses.
Thank you.
So now that I have the tree built, you can see all of the different matches that are matching the tester. And we have a lot who are descending from this one couple. Now, for anyone who has done genetic genealogy, and especially a lot of different cases where they're looking for unknown parentage, you'll instantly notice that BM, who has 377, that will be our focal point, because that's such a high match. We're looking at second cousin, first cousin once removed, somewhere in there. So we're going to be focusing on that, and I chose this case because it's very easy to see that. And so you'll be able to see as we start to place our hypotheses where our most likely place of our tester is in this family tree. Now, to place the hypotheses, all we need to do is start to add other children in. And we don't really need to name these children, but this is how we are going to figure out where the most likely place is that we are going to find our tester. So adding in these children, you'll see that I went up to the grandparent, because when we're looking at 377, that's probably not going to be a first cousin. It's very possible to be a first cousin once removed. And then it's also very possible to be a second cousin. So we basically want to build out the tree, and we're going to place our hypotheses there. So here, this is going to be an aunt or an uncle. And so if we place the hypothesis here, you'll see that we get a score of 0. And when you get a score of 0, that literally means that there's no likely way that our tester could be in that position in the family tree based on the shared centimorgans. Now, the trees here do not account for endogamy, and they also don't account for special types of relations, such as double cousins or three-quarter siblings. So if there's something going on like that, you're not going to be able to get it here. One thing they do let you account for is they do let you account for half-siblings. So here we're going to add another child, and when we go down here, you're going to see now we have defined half-relationships. So let's say that maybe it's a half-sibling. It's not a full sibling. So we do that, and we're going to define it as JM and hypothesis 1. So we're going to close it. So you'll see that JM and hypothesis 1 now have the same purple lines, whereas this child has the yellow line indicating a half relationship. So now we're going to use this as a hypothesis, and you'll see it's still a score of 0, because even as a half uncle, that there's just no way that this person could be at this point in the tree and share DNA with everybody like they are. But this is just to show you how you can define half relationships. But we're going to take this out of here. But now we're going to put in our hypotheses right here, and we'll see that we get a 1. So it's likely that we can have it. The only other hypothesis it's going against is this one, which is a score of 0. But you'll notice the scores change as we enter in more hypotheses, because it's not, the score isn't telling you how likely it is. It's telling you how likely it is against the other hypotheses. And the general rule that I've heard is that you want that score to be 20 times more than the other hypotheses. If it's not 20 times more than the other hypotheses, then it might be just about as likely as that other hypothesis. So we're going to make this child, we're going to use this as a hypothesis, because this would make it a second cousin. And now we're going to see that hypothesis 3 is a score of 1, and hypothesis 2 turned into a score of 371. So that's 371 times as likely for it to be a hypothesis 2 than hypothesis 3, because hypothesis 3 is a score of 1. It's possible that hypothesis 3 is where our tester is in the tree, but it's really not as likely, because it's not likely they would share this much DNA. So we're going to keep going and adding in more hypotheses, just so you can see how the score changes as we do that. So instead, let's see if maybe Lewis had children. So we're going to add these children in. And I'm going to add the hypotheses in these generations. This is because the tester that we have was born in the 1950s. And this generation here was born mostly 1870s to 1890s. And this generation here is mostly born about 1890s to 1920s. So we're really not going to expect a baby born in 1950s to be in this generation. So it's likely going to be this generation or possibly this generation because some of these children were much older than their siblings. So here we're going to enter this as a hypothesis, and now our scores have really changed. Hypothesis 2 is now 27,799. Hypothesis 3 is 75, and now hypothesis 4 is 1. So hypothesis 4, it's possible, but it's very unlikely compared to these other hypotheses. Hypothesis 3, that's definitely going to be much more likely than hypothesis 4, but still it's nowhere close to hypothesis 2. So we're going to add another hypothesis here, and we'll see we get another score of 0. And whenever you get a score of 0, it's not really going to affect the other scores because score of 0 just means that there's no possible way that you would be matching all of these people the way you are without it being something else happening. So we can go through and we can add a lot more of these hypotheses, but you really don't need to because we've already basically figured it out. If we had another high relationship, we could keep going just to show you a little bit more. We will add some. So we're going to just add a hypothesis here, another 0, add a hypothesis here, another 0. And let's add some children here. And hypothesis 0, hypothesis 0. Now, one of the things I do want to point out is that when you are getting into these different matches and entering in the matches, you want to make sure that you are choosing matches that are over 50 centimorgans of shared DNA, even if they are descending from the same family. If you are getting your matches off of Ancestry, you also have the possibility of having matches that are skewed by the Timber algorithm. The Timber algorithm is something that is taking your DNA segments, analyzing them against large populations, and pieces of those segments that are found to be extremely common among large populations are then being taken out of your matches in a way of trying to hone in on significant matches and to take out matches that are just not significant. But it's not always correct. And you may find some matches that are just out of whack. Now, I actually have an example that goes along with this tree. There is a cousin from another sibling. So we're actually going to add another child here. And this child actually is Bessie. Do not want to do that. So that's how you delete it if you accidentally add a child just like that. But anyway, back to Bessie. Bessie had a child. We're going to call that child AO. And AO had a child. And we're going to call them JL. Now, JL only matches at 28 centimorgans. Even though JL is the match that is in the oldest generation, all of the other matches are one generation further or more, JL is matching at the lowest amount. Now, when we put in these centimorgans, you're going to see how it completely skews the rest of the hypotheses. So JL is only matching at 28. Sorry, I think I might have said 23 before, but it's 28. So we're going to hit save. And now you'll see all of a sudden everything has gone to 0. The only thing that's possible is hypothesis 7. And the reason for this is because if JL is matching at only 28 centimorgans, there is no way that our tester could be in this position or this position or this position. There's no way they could be in any of these positions except for hypothesis 7, because it just couldn't happen. And in fact, if we add a child and then we add another hypothesis here, you'll notice all of a sudden now we have hypothesis 7 being 6,242, hypothesis 8 being 1. And then we're going to go ahead, we're going to take this out, remove the centimorgans, and oh my gosh, big change. Now, I think this is from the Timber algorithm skewing things. It's not for sure exactly what's going on. There is a Facebook What Are the Odds group, and there have been multiple discussions I've seen where the Timber algorithm has been discussed in how it affects the What Are the Odds tool. I believe that that is what's happening here, is Timber has caused this match to have a much lower amount of centimorgans shared than they really do, because a lot of those shared segments have been stripped away because they're very commonly found among large groups of people. But in this case, those segments are significant, and by taking those away, it's skewing our results. We can see by all of these different hypotheses we've added, hypothesis 6 is the likely place. And in fact, we have already proven this case that this is where the tester is in the family. But if you have matches that just aren't correct, if they've been skewed or if they're just too low, then it's going to really mess things up. And that includes with endogamous populations and the double cousins and three-quarter siblings or special types of relations. Thank you so much for checking out my first tutorial video. If you enjoyed, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. You can also subscribe. It's completely free to do so. If you'd like to help support the channel, please visit my Patreon and become a patron at GeneaVlogger, and you can also follow me on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram at GeneaVlogger. I'm the GeneaVlogger. I'll see you in my next video.